like to open up the council meeting of Wednesday, June 15, 2016. Councilmember Chapman? Councilmember Clayton?
Here.
Councilmember Kendall?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
Would everybody please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please? Flag salute. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. Next item is proclamation recognizing Asbury Park Day.
Whereas a group of Asbury Park citizens came together to foster understanding between the different communities within the city, and whereas this group did agree that through collaboration, the city of Asbury Park as a whole would benefit from establishing Asbury Park Day, a unified celebration of community, and whereas Asbury Park Day is a celebration of the valuable contributions of Asbury Park's beautiful, diverse tapestry of cultures, faiths, families, and individuals of all ages, and whereas all residents of Asbury Park are vital to the fabric of our community and therefore are encouraged to celebrate our common unity through entertainment and education aimed at enhancing the quality of life for all. And whereas the celebration of Asbury Park Day will promote unity, the essential bond and catalyst for the advancement, enhancement, well-being, growth, and success for the city at large. Be it furthermore resolved that the mayor and council do hereby commend this group of individuals for their care for and commitment to our city and wish them much success on the inaugural celebration of Asbury Park Day on Saturday, June 25th, 2016. And who is going to receive the proclamation?
Next item. Next item is matters by city council. Anybody have any matters?
I'm just going to repeat what we said Monday. Our heartfelt condolences to the families and victims of the Orlando shooting. I want to commend three bars that held vigils on Sunday night. It was Hotel Tides, Ryan, Paradise Jojo, and Joe Cole from Georgie's, where they put three separate vigils on to show their support to the Orlando victims. And Friday night, Paradise is hosting a fundraiser where all the proceeds go to the victims of the Orlando attack. The event starts at 10 o'clock at Paradise, and the suggested donation is $5.
On Saturday, June 16th, the opening of the Springwood Avenue Park will be at 12 o'clock, and everyone is invited. Please come out. It's going to be a really exciting day on Springwood Avenue. There are a number of events going on, including a car show and another festival. So please come out and spend the day and celebrate with us.
Jason?
Yes, I would like to volunteer. I,
I don't know the procedures behind it, to this summer, you know, school is letting out and crowds are becoming Asbury. I like to volunteer to ride along in the police car maybe once or twice a week, or even walk up and down with the specialists. I don't know if I have to talk to city manager, the mayor, or whoever's in charge of this, or is it just because it's volunteer I could do this? Any comment on that?
Talk to the city manager.
That's a good idea.
Mike?
I'll work with Salerno, the insurance company, yeah. We'll get that.
All right. I also would like to give, we have seasonal workers, the DPW people. I think they're doing an outstanding job. A lot of them would like to be employed, so they're working the hardest they can, and hope if some way or another we can come up with a grant to keep a lot of these kids. A lot of them have been troubles at one time or another in their lives, and they realize now that only way they're gonna make it is work hard. They're gonna work by the sweat of their brow, and they'll be able to overcome a lot of things that they thought that if they can get out there and rob somebody, that's the easiest way. But now that they got jobs, I like to try to keep them jobs if we can come up with something one way or the other. And I think that's about it. Thank you.
Arlene?
I have nothing.
I have nothing?
Matters by the city manager?
Thank you, Ms. Dye. On the consent agenda resolutions, 2016-250, which is approving the special events wedding applications as presented on Monday, there was an application that was missed. It was the Jersey Shore Triathlon. They actually submitted this application last September, and it was lost in paperwork in our offices. The police, fire, and public works have all signed off on it. Leisha Floyd has been in contact with them, apologizing for our error. Staff has signed off on it. So I'd like to make a recommendation that that resolution is amended to include the Jersey Shore Triathlon with the organization of Split Second Racing to have their event this Sunday for their triathlon. Resolution 2016-256, myself and the auditor requesting that that just be pulled. We'll do that on the 29th. And then I'd like to give some explanation for resolution. First, I'll go with 2016-271 and 2016-273.
And can you add 2016-262?
Yes, I can explain that again.
Okay.
Resolution 273 is an amendment to the 2016 municipal budget, the beach utility, which coincides with 2016-271, which is a purchase of a John Deere tractor for the beach utility. Our beach cleaning tractor has broken beyond repair. Currently, we're borrowing other municipalities, so we have to amend the utility budget in order to buy the John Deere tractor. It is off a national cooperative, approximately $75,000. What we're looking at is the same model that Lock Arbor and Bradley Beach have, so everyone is interchangeable and makes it more efficient in the long term. So we're recommending a passing of those two resolutions. The deputy mayor just asked for a briefing of 2016-262, which is a resolution authorizing the execution of the second modification of the Stronger New Jersey Neighborhood and Community Revitalization Program, Streetscape Subrecipient Agreement. This is the grant that the city received from the Economic Development Authority, EDA, for the boardwalk lights. This just ensures that we get our paperwork done in time, the lights are complete. It's just paperwork, and EDA just asked us to pass this so that it can be, we're in compliance with the final paperwork. And lastly, I mentioned this on Monday, there is Resolution 2016-270, which is a resolution of the mayor and council of the city of Asbury Park supporting submission of an application for New Jersey Department of Transportation Safe Routes to School program. This program costs the city nothing. It is a fully reimbursable grant. We are applying for approximately 540 $45,000 for work around Bradley Elementary School and other places if funding permits. This will be for, to increase the safety of pedestrians, kids walking and riding their bikes to school. For example, the grant calls for flashing stop signs, slow school zone street markings, repainting some ADA ramps. It will do some education, some traffic calming measures such as painting, and some investigation of, you know, improving some lighting, pedestrian countdown signals. It costs us nothing but our time, so we're recommending that this resolution be passed. It needs to be passed tonight because the deadline is the 27th, I believe, which is before, it's before the next council meeting. So if we have to do this tonight. That concludes my statement.
Matters by the city attorney?
Yes, Mayor and Council, I sent an email communication out to all of you earlier today with a copy of a draft, a brief ordinance that was requested by the Director of Property Improvement and the Zoning Officer. They requested some clarifying language in one of the sections of our existing summer rental ordinance, and I would like to request that that be put on for discussion during the next work session meeting in 2 weeks. That's it.
All right, at this time, can I have a motion to open the public portion of the meeting?
Move it.
Second. All favor?
Aye.
All opposed? The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements won't be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order, and after appropriate warning, may terminate any further comments from the speaker. Each speaker has 3 minutes to speak, and when you come up to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Pam Lamberton, Sunset Avenue. I just wanted to give you a little synopsis of Asbury Park Complete Streets. Complete Streets is dedicated to making Asbury Park as friendly as possible to pedestrians, bike riders, skateboarders, and automobiles. Our streets are for all modes of transportation, and since we have formed as a group, we have participated in bike rodeos at the elementary and middle schools, teaching children safe ways to maneuver streets on bicycles. We participated in the Safe Routes to School program, which our city manager just alluded to, which identified the safest routes for our school children, all of whom walk to school. We have given out bike lights to be attached to bicycles to make night riding safer. We reviewed the bicycle ordinance, now part of the administrative code, and made recommendations before the council approved it. And we provided the council with the latest documentation and studies regarding road diets so that they can make informed decisions regarding Main Street. In the future, our initiatives will include identifying more locations for bike racks, looking for financing for bike racks, working with the waterfront redevelopers regarding bicycle routes around, near, and on the boardwalk. We're going to review and make recommendations to the council regarding the city code as it pertains to all modes of transportation on the boardwalk. We will identify intersections in need of improvements for pedestrian safety. We hope to develop a citywide bike path. We want to identify and lobby to get bike paths marked. And we will investigate and make recommendations regarding back and diagonal parking. We have a Facebook page and a Google group, and we would love anybody who wants to join us in our efforts. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Moore, City Council, Chief Ketty, City Manager, City Attorney Michael Kushner, 511 Asbury Avenue, and soon to be, God willing, 1100 Fifth Avenue. We're actually ready to close on a house. I prepared a statement that also as a member of the Asbury Park Complete Streets Committee Coalition I wanted to share with you. As a resident like you, I want to see the streets of Asbury Park safe for all users and all modes of transportation. As a member of the Asbury Park Complete Streets Coalition, I was very happy to hear about your meeting with NJDOT this past Monday. I understand you discussed state funding, among other things, assigned tasks, and hopefully revisited making State Road 71 a true, safe, accessible Main Street. Regarding the reconfiguration of Main Street, We want to let you know that you have broad support from dozens of business owners and hundreds of residents who have taken the time to educate themselves and learn what this means for them and the city. We have a letter endorsed by many businesses on Main Street, Cookman, and elsewhere in AP, urging the city to reverse its position on the road diet plan for Route 71 that was presented by NJDOT last year, and consider a reconfiguration of Main Street that meets with the complete streets policy that our city's adopted. We also have a petition encouraging the same, which was signed by hundreds of AP residents and visitors who want bicycles and pedestrian improvements to create a safer Main Street for residents and tourists alike. These improvements will also have an economic benefit for the businesses on Main Street, as countless case studies of similar reconfiguration plans have demonstrated. Furthermore, by showing our commitment as a forward-thinking city, dedicated to creating safer, accessible, more accommodating streets for all of our residents and visitors of all abilities, whether they walk, bike, ride a skateboard, or drive a car, it better positions Asbury Park to receive additional funding from federal, state, and county resources, as well as other investments. You have enthusiastic support from many residents and business owners to pursue creating a better, safer, complete Main Street, and we encourage and support the mayor and the council to continue to work with NJDOT to make this happen. I have copies of this letter. Could I leave this with you, one for each member?
Good evening. My name is Polly Shilga, and I live at 511 Asbury Avenue also, and also knocking on wood, our mortgage is almost ready to go for 1100 Asbury Avenue. I said Asbury. Michael alluded to the petition that I also have copies of here for you to see, almost 400 signatures in just a little over a month, and we're pretty blown away by the willingness of people to step up, and also 158 wonderful comments supporting the idea of a road diet the New Jersey Department of Transportation proposed last year. A road diet doesn't sound like a real pleasant thing because diets aren't so pleasant, but in this case, a road diet would probably provide opportunities for people to move about the city more safely, bicycles, pedestrians, and drivers alike. Not only are Asbury Park residents signatories on this petition, but they're from all over the United States, and which indicates that people who are coming here to buy houses, the new condos, to visit, the insurgence of visitors is going to be greater than ever this summer, and we're really looking for the safety of everybody who uses the streets. So we do want to say that thank you very much to Michael Capabianco for the meeting that he held with NJDOT earlier this week, and for Mayor Moore for having a walk on Main Street and interacting with people and talking to them about what they feel about the city, with along with Doug McQueen, and for participating in the conference, the Road Diet Conference, which I can only guess must have been pretty interesting. So what we're asking is that the City Council will rescind the resolution to reject the NJDOT Road Diet Plan, resolution number 2015324, in which the plan is only partially endorsed. So for all of you who are interested, we have bike lights for everybody, and we passed out some material. If anyone has any questions, we're pretty easy to get a hold of on Facebook, and we have our business cards and our email address as well. And I have the petition for you, so if I can bring that up to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Wait till she brings up the petition.
Sorry for a little bit of congestion tonight, but Ed Baumgarten, 706 4th Avenue, to the council. You guys have a thankless job, and I wanted to come here today. I was here a month ago with an ongoing problem of criminal and disturbance activity next to a house that I own on Sunset. Upon learning upon this, I have to commend the city council. I have to commend the individual offices of city manager, fire department, police department, and code enforcement. All work together to help kind of contain the situation that was going on next door to me. So really, I just want to thank the council for that. I'm going to kind of end with a question, though, and that is, how do citizens don't want to police their neighbors? And my question is, how do we as a city, as a community, act in a way to, again, for lack of a better term, make Asbury Park better? I don't know the answer. It's a question and possibly a rhetorical one. I'm here mainly to thank the council. Thank you.
I think what you did at the council meeting when you came here, you specifically said what the problem was. You gave us the address and we were able to follow up. I mean, I think that's one way. For people who don't want to do that, I get emails about, I have three emails sitting in my email now about three houses on Sunset that are problems. But I think exactly what you did.
Communication. Communication is the key. If you see something wrong, by all means, call City Hall, call the police department, call the council, email us. We all have public email addresses. I have a listed phone number. The communication. We cannot be out there everywhere, so the citizens see things we don't see. Communication is the key. And when you see something wrong, you have to report it because it helps us with many decisions down the road.
And I think I learned that a number of years back, but I know that many of my neighbors don't feel that way. I mean, I've spoken to people like, oh, this is going on. I tell them, call the police immediately.
Yes.
Like, oh, I don't know if I want to do that. And I don't know how that message gets across.
They don't want to call the police because they're scared of neighborhood retaliation or something like that. They can call the city manager's office and he'll be very discreet. They can send emails to me and I'll be very discreet. And all I do is I forward them to the city manager and say, please look into this.
And we can, so I have currently a problem going on Sunset. I just take out the concerns and I say they're from me. So I forward them to Michael. I say, I have these concerns at 1101 Sunset Ave. Can you look into them and give me a report? And then I shoot it off to the person who sent the concern. So then there's never any chance of retaliation because I'm the one making. I mean, if the retaliation's anywhere, it's at me.
And again, I mean, on my end, I mean, personally, I understand it. How does that message get out to some of the people, a number of whom are part-timers, a number of whom are really just down here just to enjoy themselves?
Word of mouth, just like you can tell your neighbors, and word of mouth, this will be on APTV. They'll see it. They'll be communicated through the communications officer. I think it's been communicated worldwide, but what happened in Orlando. I mean, if you see something, you have to report it. It's a crazy world. And, you know, if you think there's something wrong, by all means, report it. The worst thing you can do is, like, you overreact a little bit. Better to overreact than not react.
That's again, one of the things that we can't overemphasize. I spoke on this Monday night. If you see something, please say something. And we're going to have to come together as a town and say, hey, let's pass the word around, just like the complete streets are doing. We're going to have to do more communication, as the both of the council people had said. But we have to help ourselves. We need to wake up and stop keeping it to ourselves. If you see something, say something about it. And don't be afraid, because you have a lot of people behind you, including the police department, city council, everything. So it's up to you to pass the word also, as we will.
Trying. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mayor, City Council. My name is Melissa C. Williams, and I am from Neptune. But I'm an entrepreneur for over 20 years, and my mom's had a wig store in the 70s and 80s here in Asbury Park. And I'm here today because I've been teaching entrepreneurship for a long time, and I've started a program called the Kids in Biz program, entrepreneurship program. I have a full curriculum, books, and plays, and I'm here because I wanted to propose starting my own entrepreneurship school in Asbury Park. I was told by a friend of mine, Shauna Femulero, that in order for me to even get this started, that I would have to bring a proposal to the city council meeting, which is why I took off work today. And I have a copy of the actual, I have one copy of the proposal here today to give to you. I've been also teaching this program for years in the area at the Asbury Park VFW. Some people know me from the SPOT program at the high school, the Bucky James. It's been on Channel 12 News and in the Asbury Park in the press several times, as well as the Coaster. And like I said, I just wanted to bring in, drop off this proposal, which I did send in the mail about a month ago. I'm not sure if anybody saw it or not, to propose an entrepreneurial school. And I don't know exactly the process that I have to follow. So if you could give me some direction, that would be great.
I think your best bet, and I'm sorry, I think you got a little bit of wrong. I'm happy you're here tonight. I'm sorry you had to take off a night of work. Call the city manager's office and set up a meeting, and he'll have the proper people there to facilitate your needs.
Okay.
Your request to see what we can do.
Okay. So this letter that I typed up for the city council, should I give it to you today or the city manager?
Who? Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
And he'll give you his phone number and set up a meeting with him. I'm sure he'll have the communications director there.
Okay.
He's helping with businesses.
Should I leave you my brochure?
Linda? Hi, I'm Linda Leahy from Fifth Avenue. I just wanted to bring up a problem that has been bothering me for a while with the trees that are in front of my house on the sidewalk. They're sycamore trees, and they are already, as you can see, they're still green, and they're already falling off the trees. So I started looking at them on the other side, and they have some type of fuzzy stuff on the back of them, like something is eating them, and something is evidently eating around, whether it's caterpillars, I haven't seen caterpillars, but something is eating it right off of the stem. This tree is a little different. I think this is a maple, and that has some kind of something on it too. But I have all these leaves laying in the by the curb that are dying. And I was wondering if there was someone who really knows about the diseases of trees that could come and look at them. I've noticed several places, other places on my street and on other streets where I've seen leaves falling off the trees already. And it's, you know, it's only the beginning of summer. And so that was one problem. And then the other thing that kind of bothered me was the trees that are in front of the restaurant down the street here on Main Street that have lights on them. And they're like a very tight net over the tree. And a tree is not supposed to be confined. It's supposed to grow, you know, and spread its branches. And I really feel that the town should make them take those lights down. You know, if they want to put lights around the tree, like just the trunk, or, but they've got it, if you look at it, it looks like something you would put over a bush. You've probably seen them. So that was the other thing that's been bothering me for a while. And I love trees, so.
I think Tom Pavinsky, if you leave me your phone number, I'll have Tom Pavinsky, who's the chair of the Environment and Shade Tree Commission, come out and take a look at your trees. I think he's the
okay.
Tree expert.
I know I had
your
left
phone number or email, though?
I left a message on his phone, but he didn't get back to me yet.
You know what? He's not great on voicemail. He's better on email.
Oh, okay. I don't have that.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. I'll take care of it. Just give me your contact information, and I'll do it.
Okay. And just to talk about, real quickly, about the bicycles, when I came down Main Street this afternoon, there was a fellow riding a bike, and he was right in with the traffic and shooting in and out, going around a bus and up on the sidewalk. And I thought, you know, there should be a few rules on how you ride your bike. So anyway, thanks.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Annette Harrell, and I reside in the Asbury Park Village in Asbury. My first question or comment is, we're having a lot of problems with Atkins Avenue as far as the traffic. There's been a lot of hit and runs. A lot of our cars have been, the rearview mirrors have been knocked off, especially on the weekends. Fridays and Saturdays are really bad over there. The speed limit is out of this world. And we have said things many of times, called the police, told them about it, whatever. But I think that they really need to come over there and be over there on Fridays and Saturdays, because that's when we have the most traffic. You know, it's the weekend, everybody's off, and they want to party, drink, and whatever. And this is becoming a big issue, because not only the cars are getting hit, they're getting hit and they keep going. So we end up the ones that have to pay the bill of the damage. And everybody doesn't have full coverage, or we don't know what kind of coverage they have. Sometimes it doesn't cover it. So this has been an ongoing issue for a couple of years now. The second thing that I want to bring to your attention is, I go to the Board of Commissioner meetings in the Asbury Park Housing Authority. And there was an issue that happened there with a commissioner. I did my homework. I did the paper trail. I also talked to the mayor about this situation. And HUD advised me that the situation needs to be handled by the city. I don't know how true that is or who is responsible. I know that they are appointed by you guys. So I need an answer, how are we gonna handle this situation that occurred?
I don't wanna cut off your time, so are you done?
Yes.
Okay, well, we'll start with the speeding. I'm sure Mike will be in touch with the deputy chief first thing in the morning, and if need be, we can move the sign over there, and there'll be more police patrols. As far as, I'm not sure whoever gave you that information is correct. Let us talk to Tyrone Garrett as far as who has jurisdiction over commissioners. We appoint, but I think they govern. So
Tyrone, not to interrupt you, but Tyrone Garrett is the active ED over there. He does not have the power to do anything as far as the Board of Commissioners. They have the power over him. They tell him what to do. So it's a discrepancy there.
It would be like if I did something wrong and brought up like ethics charges. Mm-hmm. Michael has the power to report me to Trenton. Mm-hmm. I don't think we have the power. We'll look into it, we'll talk to Tyrone, we'll find out. Tyrone is the acting executive director, but he's appointed by the trustees of the Housing Authority. So it's just like he is in charge.
Right. He does have acted on it. He got in touch with HUD. HUD informed him that the city of Asbury Park is the ones that are responsible to get involved with this situation and handle this situation. He did do his homework and he did assist me, him and the Long Branch Administrative Office.
Tyrone's never told us about this, so this is the first time we're hearing about it, so we'll get in touch with Tyrone tomorrow.
Okay, thank you.
We need more information,
right?
Because if she's talking about an issue of potentially removing a member of the Housing Authority, the council appoints, and the council can also remove for grounds. But we need more information, and we can follow up.
Right.
I have letters, and I also sent letters to the council, so I don't know if everyone got one, but I have plenty.
No, I know, and you and I have talked, but
yes.
Again, we'll reach out to Tyrone, because this is the first time we're hearing that Tyrone said it's on us.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't get your letters out either. Can you email them to Mike?
I don't email, but I have them on me.
Okay.
So I can give it to you. And Tyrone also wrote a letter as well over with mine.
Do you have copies? Give them to Michael? Because
yep.
I'm not even aware of the situation you're talking about.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello, Felicia Simmons, Asbury Park, 307th Avenue. I'm here to talk about a big concern through the city is housing. It is important and it's needed. In fact, I seen Ms. Amy Quinn a couple weeks ago in housing court, housing landlord-tenant court, the other Friday. It's a huge epidemic. And in Asbury Park, the pricing living here is becoming such a huge financial burden. There's been a program that I know about that's being developed that been put to the council about housing opportunities to stimulate the growth in Asbury Park for low income, medium income, and high income. There's been ordinances placed in other cities like Patterson that protects all phases of growth in their city, like Asbury Park that protects the artists, that protects the low income, that protects all the different groups of people here in Asbury. I had a conversation with a commissioner in a housing authority that happens to be a real estate agent who speaks about the fact that she's outpriced in the city and she can't find any place for a person to live in this city. It's a huge problem. It is not just my problem, it's everybody's problem. I'm here as a person who works two jobs. I don't sit at home and I still can't afford to live here because after your lease run out, your landlord can up the price every month as long as he gives you 30 days notice. Right, that's in the city. I know a person whose rent went from $850 and in a month it'll be $1,350, right, down on Fifth Avenue in Asbury. It's something that is out of control and it's affecting everyone. So I'm here with a list of people who are ready to buy into Asbury, but we need help from people that sit up there to have concern for everybody in Asbury to live here, to keep the culture here, to keep the heart of Asbury here, that everybody comes in love to keep it here, not to be priced out. The new condos are going for $450,000 for a one-bedroom condo. That's starting. So it's only gonna grow. Forbes magazine lists a deal as one of the best upcoming expensive cities. That's right next door to us. So that's creeping into Asbury Park. They come from all over the world to Asbury because the great culture, but that culture is gonna die and everybody's gonna be priced out soon if we don't do something here in the city to protect us.
Thank you.
So I'm just gonna put my attorney hat on for a second. So Felicia, one thing is that, and you can certainly have anyone call our office, a landlord can't raise your rent an unconscionable amount, even when your lease is up. What's unconscionable is generally decided by a judge, but arguably 8 to 13 would be an unconscionable number, right? So you should have that person call my office. And the other thing is, and this is not Asbury related, but and this is not the solution to the problem, but Section 8 waiting list is open. It opened on Monday and it's open till Friday, meaning yes. You can get a Section 8 voucher, you apply online. The only thing you have to have is an email, and if you have trouble applying online, you can call my, again, I'm speaking as a nonprofit attorney. You can call my office and we'll help you with the application. And it is only open until Friday at 5:00. So anyone who doesn't know, federal Section 8 vouchers are subsidized housing. However, they are portable, so you can live anywhere in Asbury Park or quite frankly, anywhere in the United States. One of the reasons they're valuable vouchers is because they're based on your income. So if you are on the lower spectrum of the income scale, they base your rent on that, say $200 a month on a $1,300 a month apartment. So just FYI, this Section 8 list is open. I'm not suggesting that is, you know, in any way, shape, or form the solution for Asbury Park. I'm just putting that out because you asked me housing questions and I just go into auto mode.
I've been on a Section 8 list for close to 10 years.
Okay. All right, anyone
who's not on it, it's open. Good evening, Reggie Flimlin, 506 8th Avenue homeowner and business owner of Juice Basin in Asbury Park. Good evening, council. and neighbors. So I'm all for the Safe Street Coalition, rock on. I wanted to comment on the trees. I think about 6 months ago, I had commented on the 8th Avenue and Grand Avenue trees, and Tom Pavinsky, Heart of Gold. I just feel like the man is probably doing way too much because he's doing the gardens and he does a lot for us. Is there nobody that has that job to actually look at the health and wellness of the trees?
Within the city?
Within the city? Would that not go under City Council or Public Works or something?
Is there a city arborist? No.
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 Do we used to have one? No, guess not. Okay.
And there's not a master, I mean, Tom's also a master gardener.
No, I know. I know. He's great. But I think that he's got so much going on because we talked about the trees on 8th and the missing trees now on Grand that just died off. So it is a concern, right? I was just curious about the bridge over Sunset. I've been out of the loop for a while, and I didn't know if that's going to be repaired. If there's money in the budget
open.
For that.
It's open? They just rebuilt it.
Yay! Like I said, I've been kind of busy. And I had a question regarding Asbury Park residents. I remember a few years ago, a young man drowned who went up to the ocean after 6 when the lifeguards went off. And I thought as a city and a community decided that, you know what, it's kind of ridiculous to make people that are disadvantaged, economically disadvantaged, that are residents of the city, have to wait to 6 o'clock till the lifeguards come off for them to swim. So I thought we said that it was okay for folks to go up there at 5 o'clock and start swimming without a pass. Did that change or did that never change and I'm just delusional?
I think it never changed, but I'm not going to call you delusional.
I guess they never enforced it then. So what had happened in the past is that folks would come with children in tow from the west side and wait till the lifeguards left, and then they'd go in the water. And then over the past, like, 2 years, I think we got a little lax, which is a great thing, and said, you know what? It's 5 o'clock. Why don't you head up there and go swimming while the lifeguards are still there, and then at 6 o'clock, they get pulled out of the water with everybody else. And I just feel that if the city truly loves its residents and loves those that are economically disadvantaged, that they should have residents have the ability at 5 o'clock to swim in the ocean for an hour with a lifeguard, with their family and their friends. Because people that are day trippers or people that are going out are going already into the places that they're out partying and stuff. And I don't think anybody here that pays for an annual fee like myself would mind letting the lifeguards from 5 or 6 actually work with some of the residents that don't have the money to go swimming. So I'm proposing whatever I'm proposing with regards to that. I think it's a safety measure.
Well, on week, especially weekend, I think our hours go to 6, not to 5.
No, that's what I'm saying. You should have it so enforce it.
Beach hours go to 6 already.
Right.
And on very hot days when we keep lifeguards on extra to make sure there are no tragedies because so many people are swimming for free.
Right. I understand it's till 6 o'clock.
There's no set time. The lifeguards don't, like, there is beach bathing hours, right? You have to pay. But then after that, we keep lifeguards on extra at this taxpayer's cost.
Right.
To make sure nobody who's down there swimming for free has a tragedy.
So what I'm saying is why not let people swim for free at 5 o'clock when we're already paying for the lifeguards and nobody's really up there?
We'll look into it, but I don't know if we legally can do it.
Oh, why?
It's just okay. Like people say, why can't we give Asbury Park residents a discount for beach bathing? Because it's against the law. Everybody has to pay the same fee.
Right, but I think you can open your beaches to free at 5 o'clock. I don't think there's a law that says you can't open the beach at 5 to 6 for free bathing.
Let us look into it, but we're also under transitional aid, where I think the state would say, no, we're giving you transitional aid, and you're taking in X amount of dollars because of beach revenue, and you're not going to reduce that until you're off transitional aid. And
we'll look into it, Reggie.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Michael, correct me if I'm wrong about the transitional aid.
Before you go on, we have seats, gentlemen, if you want to sit down. If not, if you're going to talk, get in line, because we have more than enough seats. Thank you.
And Reggie, we will look into it. And I think our hours are already to 6, but
Right, so she's saying let people on for free.
That's fine.
Last hour.
Let Michael look into it and get back to us.
Hi, my name is Sharon Leak. I'm 1317 Washington Avenue in Asbury Park. I just really want to just take the time to just thank Asbury for letting us have an Asbury Day. I also want to just give a special thanks to Yvonne, because I have never really tried to do something like this, because I have a special love for the kids in Asbury. I had a youth ministry for over 2 years, and I find it really sad that these kids don't have anything to do. Like, there's not enough love for these kids. So I'm thinking with the Asbury Day, we'll bring the families together, the kids together, and everybody together. So I'm glad that, you know, that's going to happen. But what I'm not happy about is that, you know, we have tried to meet with the city councilor, because there was a few things that we thought, maybe being that it was an Asbury Day, because everything so far is really coming out of pocket, and we do have some really good things set up. We're going to have an all-faith prayer breakfast over at the Trinity Church, where Bob Gary, he stepped up and he, you know, did that, and Triumph of Life is doing. Some people are joining in and doing some things, but it was some things that we really needed from the city that we was trying to reach out to get, but we haven't been successful in getting a meeting with the city manager. And also we tried to reach out to Alicia for some things that we needed from the city. And all I'm asking is that they would just at least give us a call and try to, like, you know, help us, because we got everything pretty much set for that this year anyway for Asbury Day. So, you know, we just need a few more things to try to make it, you know, fun and enjoyable for everybody. That's all.
And again, we thank you for your effort. And I think, get in touch with me, because I think you're getting part of the story, because some people from your group were told to go to special events, set up a meeting with the city manager, and put in an application, and that just never happened. Now, I can lead the horse to water, but I can't make it drink. So the process was explained what to do, and it wasn't done. So we cannot just, like, say, here's this, unless it goes to special events, and then it has to be approved at that committee, then comes before mayor and council, then we approve it, and that's the process that has to be followed for everybody. Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, and again, thank you for all you're doing.
Thank you. Hi, John Grant, 1205 4th Avenue. I have a comment and a question. It's in regards to your resolution 258, appointing Michael Capabianto acting CFO, and 259, resolution appointing CFO. I know there might have been opportunity for the public to ask questions about that in the past, which I might have missed. I would have said it seems like a conflict of interest to me, and I hope that it does not cost the city an extra penny, and maybe Rita will back me up on that. And so that's a comment. My question is, are you actively seeking someone for the CFO position? And if not, why? And is it posted on the city's website? And if not, why?
I'll start off. Later on in the evening, a full-time CFO will be appointed. So
okay.
They will be starting July 1st. So we need a person in the position. That's why Michael Capabianco is part-time. And Michael, you can take it from there.
In March, we hired a company to conduct a search for the CFO position. There's state requirements of that you have to do. We received approximately 20 resumes, interviewed 12 people. It was myself, the consultant, Councilwoman Clayton, and the mayor. We had a part-time CFO whose last day was last Wednesday, I believe. So between this time, last Thursday to June 30th, I'm just doing the acting CFO work. From there, this full-time CFO, for the first time in a while that we've had one, will start on July 1st. And in the resolution that appoints me, there is no compensation. I'm doing it for free. It's not additional day off, not additional penny. I'm doing it for free.
Can I make a comment?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize that. I would have not come up here. So if it's been said publicly and I missed it on my Asbury Park TV, you know, I apologize. But I'm glad we have a CFO. Thank you.
Yeah, John, no problem. And at Monday's meeting, Michael said we were appointing it, but we weren't announcing the name because that person hasn't given notice yet to their, who they're working for, until they're appointed. They want to make sure they get appointed before they give notice.
I'm happy.
No, okay. I'm happy too. There's one thing, we needed a full-time CFO. The part-time CFO did a great job, but it's a five-day-a-week job in Asbury Park with us. The budget of our size and so many different pilots, so many different tax programs, everything, it's a full-time position. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Louise Murray, 1604 Grand Avenue. I feel safe to mention that address since everyone knows my position about attire on the boardwalk. Longtime resident all my life, and I still feel that there should be cover-ups. However, that being said, I heard a rumor that someone got a splinter and it cost the city $32,000. I don't know if it's true, it's a rumor, but if that be the case, all it does is play into my original feelings about what you should and should not be wearing on the boardwalk. There's no reason why people can't put shoes on them. Put a little sign out, no barefoot allowed on the boardwalk. Get those little attendants over there checking your tickets to blow the whistle and say, go get your shoes, or put a cover up on, or whatever the case may be. As far as the $32,000, if it is in fact true, there could be a lot of issues regarding that. Maybe the person had diabetes, God forbid, it got infected, I don't know. But I just want to reiterate my position about attire on the boardwalk. Thank you. Can somebody tell me if that rumor is true or false?
Michael?
I don't believe we've paid it out. I know that there's a couple lawsuits of people suing us over splinters, but I don't think there's been any payouts at this time. I'll double check. We fight those, obviously.
Well, it wouldn't be a battle, Michael, if you just take my position, but you don't want a bunch of news people sitting on your doorstep or calling you on the phone or whatever, but I still think that's the way to go.
How do you top that? Hi, Joe Grillo, 521 Cookman Avenue. I just wanted to, I wanted to commend the city council and the city officials, especially the Asbury Park Police, because since the last time that we came and spoke about the trouble that we were having in the downtown and central business district, in terms of the weekends, in terms of a lot of the noise and the fights and everything, there's definitely been an obvious presence. I mean, even when there was an issue where something was happening, probably the only incident that happened that I saw during Pride, right underneath my doorstep, my neighbor called the police and they were there within like 30 seconds, diffused the situation, and you know, kudos to really making a difference in a really quick amount of time. Obviously, the summer's still young, and there's going to be a lot of incidents. So I hope that keeps up, and we also continue to hold the businesses accountable that are the usual trouble spots. I do want to also encourage the city council to rescind the resolution rejecting the DOT road diet plan. I think that it, with all the positive steps forward that the city's making, with kind of reaching halfway, with the DOT reaching halfway as well, I think it's a great symbolic gesture, and it also shows that we're moving in the right direction. Obviously, there's still more data that needs to be collected. Obviously, DOT still has to acquiesce to a lot of the demands that we have regarding the traffic lights and everything. But I would echo the sentiments of Polly and Mike and a lot of the other people here who would like to use Main Street as a thoroughfare for bikes, for skateboarders. About 20% of our residents work in Asbury Park, and I speak to people every day that say that, you know, they would love to use Main Street as a thoroughfare where they commute, you know, via bike and board, but they can't. So I would really encourage that to happen, also because of safety issues and a lot of bikes that are on the sidewalk. So I hope that continues to move forward. So thanks.
Good evening, Mayor and Council, fellow residents, Warren Hall, Deliverance Temple Church, Pine Street in Monroe. Before I can talk about what's really important to me, I want to talk about what's really important to us. I'm very sad, heartbroken even, at what happened in Orlando. And because Asbury Park is a beautiful, multicultural, diverse community, I would be devastated if anything like that happened here. My daughter participated in the Pride Parade, and she said that someone threw Bibles at her. I'm a pastor of a church, and I'm telling you that's wrong. And I'm also telling you that it's very rarely said, and it ought to be said, and I'm going to be the one to say it, that Jesus loves all the little children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. They are all precious in his sight. It doesn't matter what your lifestyle is, alternative or what some people call normal. Everybody's got some junk in their trunk. And there's not one, no, not one, who hasn't fallen short. No one has the right to hurt other people because they're different or they're not the same as you. So I just, I'm going to keep those people, their families, and you in my prayers, and I want you to do the same for me and my family. Thank you. Now, I just want to say about Asbury Day. First of all, I'm proud of the mayor and council for declaring the fourth Saturday in June Asbury Day. Everybody else has got one. Why can't we have one? But what it is that we hope that Asbury Day will be is something that could start right here in this room tonight. And that is a type of communication, a unity, a friendship, a fellowship, a neighborly extending of a hand. For the first time, I've never met you before, but I want to shake your hand and let us begin to have a dialogue where at the end of the day, we don't have any problem coming together and addressing as a community what's best for the whole community. Because surely our kids need recreational programs. The arts community is one of the finest on the Eastern Seaboard, but does it reach over to the West Side where there's so many talented artists who are yet to be discovered? Recreation and arts. We don't have any even instruments in our public schools. So there's a lot that can be done, and I know that there are people who are waiting for an opportunity to help. So let's all get together and do what's best for Asbury. Amen? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Rita Morano, 8th Avenue. I know you tabled the $7 million tax, the note, the anticipated note, but on the bottom in the agenda, it said that we had a $15 million balance to borrow. I want to know about that, and I want to know about those workers' compensation cases. There's so many on there, but four of them have amounts of money that they're receiving. I think the public should see those minutes before they're paid, because now they're settled. And third, I want to know why Camden is suing the city of Asbury Park. And fourth, I'd like to thank the city manager for working 2 weeks free. So, the anticipated note, the $7 million? The balance at $15 million, is that after or before the $7 million?
The $15 million is what's authorized under state statute that can be borrowed of the 30% of the equalized valuation. So in other words, we can borrow up to $15 million for everything, which we won't do, have no intention to. As I explained on Monday, the tax anticipation note, which is tabled, which will come back on the 29th, is just to ensure that we have positive cash flow money to pay the bills as they come along. We will usually, in the past, have borrowed the money from the county at a 1%, 1.5% interest rate. For what's needed, we're working on the cash flow analysis to make sure that if we have to borrow, we borrow as little as possible. But the $15 million is a state number that's required in that. We will not be borrowing $15 million to do anything.
No, I know. It just said the balance on in the agenda.
Yeah, it's just the amount. Concerning the workers' comp claims, the Camden, we cannot answer that because it's ongoing litigation. And the payouts are recommended from the GIF, from our insurance fund, for either settlement or non-settlement. You'll have to give me which case you want, and I'll write up something for you for the next meeting to give to you.
Okay, and Camden, you can't talk about.
It's ongoing litigation.
That seems so far away from Asbury Park. That's why it's so strange. Huh?
No, it's not, once you know the details, but until we settle it, we can't explain the detail.
But one of the workers' comp, Bill Gray, there was no amount next to his name.
Hasn't been settled.
Oh, that's why? There's a couple like that.
If there's no amount, there's no settlement.
Yeah. Well, can we get a copy of the settlement by next week?
No, because it's ongoing litigation. There's no settlement.
No, I mean the ones that have been settled. Because now it's, you approved it.
If they're all signed, and yeah, I don't see.
The council is going to be moving forward this evening to approve three resolutions to settle workers' comp matters as recommended by the attorney for the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund, or GIF, that basically provides a defense to the city in these matters. And they're all pursuant to orders that have been entered by workers' comp judges in each one of these matters. And once the council approves the resolutions tonight, yes, there will be information that will be publicly accessible. Also, we could provide a summary of what the claim is with regard to the Camden matter, if Ms. Martin would like to come in.
I mean, these claims go back to 2000, the year 2000.
What our strategy is and what we're doing is not public information because that's ongoing litigation, but what the topic is, we could certainly give a brief synopsis of.
Okay, you have one claim from 2000, that's 16 years ago. I mean, that's why it's questionable. And the other one's 8 years old. Is there a statute of limitation on these claims? No?
You can reopen every 2 years.
Really?
Yes.
And I will say that the district attorney is vigilant in his defense of Asbury Park in all of these cases.
Hi, my name is Ernest McNulty. I'm a resident of Asbury, homeowner, 400 Deal Lake Drive. This is my first time addressing the council. I'd like to start by congratulating the preacher and the woman about the program for children for swimming, and of course your emphasis on family issues. Too often when I come here, the emphasis seems to be on business interests and a very select few businesses making a ton of money at the peril of the rest of us. And often when I see the way the sides line up, it's usually those few businesses with lots of lawyers and lots of lawyers on the boards and commissions, and then citizens trying to advocate for families, peace, justice, law and order, and following laws. And what do we have but a lot of, in my opinion, unanswered requests for help. I hear a lot about emails. Just send me an email. I've sent scores of emails about these matters, especially about children and safety in Asbury, about matters at the high school, about drugs and fighting and things that kids see, things that kids hear that are condoned. And again, I can't say enough about the words of the preacher because I'm of the same persuasion. I think Asbury is not some glitzy, come here, do what you want, disobey the law, spend a lot of money on liquor and whatever else, damage the city, and then leave, and leave us with all the consequences. So that's my first part. My second part is, I'm not used to presenting without a table. I notice when council for businesses and et cetera come before the council, they're equipped, they have their tables, their presentations. I'm not used to just coming up with not even a table, but basically what I have in my hand is two complaints that I signed against the Stone Pony and Madison Marquette for this 6, 10, 11, and 12 activities at the Stone Pony outdoor stage, at which time I spent the entire weekend with the Asbury Park Police, Fire Department, other citizens, and we witnessed horrific sights, not to mention breaking of every known noise state and local city ordinance about noise and profanity. We witnessed little children, two-month-old babies strapped to their mother's chest, being brought into the Stone Pony in the bright, unbearable sunlight on that black cement that people were sitting on, sitting in front of a stage with music that we got at about 90-plus decibels. New England Journal of Medicine says for children to hear that up that close, it damages their ear, the nerves, and their brain. So I now have two complaints, and I can't get any help from the city in terms of these summonses. Thank you. Thank you.
You can have 10 more seconds to wrap up.
I'm sorry?
You can have 10 more seconds to wrap up.
10 seconds.
So I went to the municipal court, and I can't get the police, I can't get the city or anyone to help me with these to get probable cause, because it's all documented, it all happened, and where's the city now? Like, let's go. The laws were clearly at 65 decibels, even if tonight.
Okay, that's the 10
thank
seconds. Michael, you'll look into that? And just, you bring something to my attention when you hold up the summonses. If anybody goes outside and finds a ticket on their car, it's a mistake. Do not pay it. Bring it inside. For some reason, there's a new PVO on tonight, and they didn't know not to ticket cars. So if anybody goes out after the meeting and they have a ticket, do not panic. Do not go crazy. Bring it inside, and it will be taken care of. The city manager is going to reply and get back to you.
Or another time.
Yes. Michael? Yes, you'll get back to it? Okay.
Jerry.
Hello, Mayor and Council, Jerry Scrano, Long Branch. I brought up Monday that the governor said that Asbury Park is part of the economic engine of the Jersey Shore, and we all agree with that. What I wanted to say is we always have to think out of the box to make things new or better, bring more business to town. We always want to stay ahead of the curve, and you want people to say that business complements what's already happening in town, because we want to bring in the maximum amount of tourists. Now, when I was thinking about the carousel building, I made a drawing, and I'd like Jesse to see it. That's what I believe the scale is, and that's what I think it's going to look like with the food trucks and the tents in front of the carousel building. The presenters get to spend unlimited time talking to you, and we get 5 minutes to get our point across.
Three minutes.
And that picture is worth 1,000 words, and I hope you look at it, because that's what it's going to be. What I want to say is the casino building is an iconic and a big landmark. By putting a skateboard in there, as bad as when the British took over the churches and put horses in them during the Revolutionary War. That's the way I see it. And I think you may have read about that when you were younger. Why can't, like Louise Murray said, why can't we have signs? No bare feet allowed on the boardwalk, period. Or walk at your own risk. Because the idea that people think they could sue for a splinter, most of us in this room had a splinter in our foot, and none of us got paid for it. You were lucky if your mother burned the needle and pulled it out. The other thing is, if the skateboard is so good for tourism, we have a beautiful new park on Springwood Avenue. Let's bring tourist dollars over there. And if there's so many tourists, maybe they'll put food trucks over there or into more restaurants, if it's such a good idea. If not, make them do a drawing and a feasibility report on how good the tents are, how good the food trucks are, and how good the skateboard would be in that building. I drew a sketch driving from here to Long Branch. I'm sure they have the big buck to give you a real scale drawing. And that's what I'd like you to do. You really should think about it. And I thought Louise Murray's idea about signs, you know, it makes sense. Will you ask for a feasibility report or a better drawing? But I always ask for models on new projects. Are the signs possible?
Even if we put signs up.
When you're done.
Even if we put signs up, Jerry, people can still sue us, right? Just because we say you can't sue us if you.
Nobody in this room got paid for a splinter in their foot. Thank you.
No, but you can put signs up. I mean, see what other beaches.
Caution splinters on this wood.
That's not good.
Motion to close public?
Move it.
Second. All in favor? We're on to minutes. We have three sets of minutes tonight. May 23rd, 2016 workshop, May 25th, 2016 executive, and May 25th, 16 regular. Can I have a motion to accept the minutes, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to the consent agenda. All matters listed on the consent agenda are presented collectively to the City Council. If anybody wished to have any of those items removed, to have a separate vote, please advise. We have five resolutions. 2016-250, approving special events. Wedding application as presented on June 13, 2016, along with the amendment the city manager mentioned this evening. Resolution 2016-251, resolution authorizing payment and payroll in amount of $1,090,230.53. Resolution 2016-252, resolution ratifying the appointment of tax collector for the city of Asbury Park. 2016-253, resolution authorizing compensation payment to Diane Vada upon her separation of employment. And 2016-254, authorizing appointments to the Asbury Park TV committee. Would anybody like any of those resolutions removed from the consent agenda?
No, but do you want to just name the people? You know, we said we were going to name people when we put them on committees.
Yeah.
I can name them. Yeah. It's Jill Bartlett and Hannah Walker are on APTV.
Can I have a motion to approve those five resolutions?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Kendall or Chapman?
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you. Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
On to individual resolutions. The first one is resolution 2016-246. Resolution of the Mayor and City Council of the City of Asbury Park designating Interfaith Neighbors Inc. as a redeveloper of a parcel known as the Turf Club, Block 803, Lots 1 through 14, in the Springwood Avenue redevelopment area and approving a redeveloper agreement by and between the city and Interfaith Neighbors. Can I have a motion to approve resolution 2016-246?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution
1 second, just because this is pretty historic. Interfaith is going to start building affordable units at the Turf Club location, so we thank Interfaith, and it goes back to the young lady, Ms. Simmons, asking about more affordable housing in Asbury Park. So, thank you.
Resolution 2016-255, resolution authorizing a payment of bills in the amount of $1,979,002.82. Have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-256 has been pulled from this agenda. Resolution 2016-257, resolution authorizing refunds for bid deposit. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second. Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-258, appointing Michael Capabianco, acting CFO. Have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-259, resolution appointing a CFO. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second. Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Question. We're not?
No, because she has not informed her employer yet. Tomorrow we can release the name.
It's public once they adopt the resolution.
So we're going to vote yes, then you say the name?
Yeah. She just wanted to make sure you voted on it.
Right.
By all means.
So it's public once you vote on the resolution.
Wow.
So, yeah, so.
I'm not done.
Go ahead.
So say the name now.
She's a cautious woman.
Say the name now.
Joanne Booz.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-260, appointing Phoenix Consultant to provide fiscal management services on an as-needed basis. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Can you explain that? I missed that.
Michael, he wants an explanation for the Phoenix Consulting.
It's a resolution authorizing up to not to an exceed amount of $10,000 for Phoenix Advisors for any financial management items that come up that cannot be handled. It's for advice. I don't anticipate using them more than maybe $1,000, but it's something that we want to have, like the temporary, the tax anticipation note in our back pocket in case something comes up.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-261, authorizing change order number 2 for Springwood Avenue Park. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-262, resolution authorizing the execution of the second modification of Stronger New Jersey Neighborhood and Community Revitalization Program Streetscape Subrecipient Agreement. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-264, resolution approving certain liquor licenses for 2016 through 2017 licensing year. You did receive a revised resolution at your dais tonight. I just upgraded the ones who have actually made payment and cleared all their qualifications, and I did remove the one that we spoke about earlier.
And this is the first of two such resolutions. The first batch are being renewed with this resolution this evening. The remaining licenses will be up for consideration at your next regular meeting in 2 weeks.
Can you read the licenses being approved tonight? We haven't. Does the public have
it? It was up on the website.
Okay, read it, please.
Hey, I'm sorry. When you say comments, do you mean from us?
No.
Well, we can't comment?
No.
Okay.
Craig, can you read them? Because I gave my resolution away.
Yes. The licenses which are up for renewal in this resolution this evening without any special conditions imposed include the following. PF LLC for premises at 705-707 Main Street, trade name Garcia/Tapidia. The next one, Ohana Kitchen Company for premises located at 700 Cookman Avenue for premises known as Langosta Lounge. The third one, Asbury One Liquor License LLC, which is a pocket license. The next one, Espinosa Inc. for premises located at 715 Second Avenue, premises known as Posilipos, or formerly known as Posilipos. The next one is Monmouth Lodge number 122 IBPOE for premises located at 1101 Asbury Avenue, and that's the Monmouth Lodge. The next one is Pettibone Paradise LLC for premises located at 101 Asbury Avenue for premises known as Paradise. The next one is AP Restaurant 2 LLC for premises located at 800 Ocean Avenue for premises known as Watermark. The next one is Bond Street Bar and Grill LLC for premises located at 208 Bond Street, trade name Bond Street Bar and Grill. The next one is 1411 Kingsley Street LLC for premises located at 1409 Kingsley Street. The next one is TPD Inc. for premises located at 632 Madison Avenue, known as Taka Restaurant. The next one is AP Restaurant 4 LLC for premises located at 1000 Ocean Avenue, Langosta. The one that I previously mentioned as Langosta Lounge was actually Langosta Lounge slash Pop's Garage. This one is Langosta. The next one, GTJM Inc. for premises located at 1405 Asbury Avenue, trade name Jimmy's Italian Restaurant. The next one is AP 30 Property Holdings LLC for premises located at 1300 Ocean Avenue, known as Tiki Bar slash Aqua. The next one is George-EE Inc. for premises located at 801-812 Fifth Avenue, known as Georgie's. The next one is Durango Inc. for premises located at 208 Main Street, trade name Jimmy. The next one is McLoon's Asbury Park LLC for premises located at 1213 Boardwalk regarding McLoon's Asbury Grill. The next one is Empress Hotel LLC for premises located at 101 Asbury Avenue, and that's the Empress Hotel slash Paradise. The next one is 210 Fifth Avenue Venture Urban Renewal LLC for premises located at 1100 Ocean Avenue, known as the Asbury. And the last one without restriction is AP Vines LLC for premises located at 644 Cookman Avenue, known as Lush. And obviously there are some plenary retail consumption licenses in there, as well as plenary distribution licenses and also hotels. There are, in addition, certain licenses which are being renewed, but which have special conditions that will be imposed on them as recommended from the Asbury Park Police Department. The resolution is going to be available after tonight's meeting, and you can feel free to get a copy of it to see what those special conditions are, but I'm just going to go through the list of those that are subject to special conditions to be approved tonight. The first one is Akshay Enterprises, Inc. for premises located at 1002 Main Street, Middlebrook Bar and Spirits. The next one is Asbury Pub, LLC, premises located at 552 Cookman Avenue, which is Brickwall Tavern. Next one, Cookman LLC, premises located at 162-166 Main Street, known as Brando's. The next one, 1211 Main Street LLC, premises located at 1213 Main Street, known as Cameo. The next one, Stone Pony Liquor License LLC, premises located at 909-913 Ocean Avenue for the Stone Pony. The next one is Enigma Restaurant LLC for premises located at 408 7th Avenue, Enigma Restaurant. The next one, Sixth Gear Enterprises LLC for premises located at 649 Madison Avenue, which is the Exchange on Madison. The next one is AP Restaurant 3 for premises located at 1213 Ocean Avenue, known as the Wonder Bar. The next one is Asbury F&B LLC for premises located at 1401 Ocean Avenue, the Berkeley Hotel. Oh, and one more, the name is Robert Perez for premises located at 1005 Memorial Drive, known as Super Extra Liquors. And that is all of the licenses which are being considered for renewal this evening.
Thank you.
Can I have a motion to adopt resolution 2016-264?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to resolution 2016-265, authorizing appointments to the Wesley Lake Commission. This appointment will be Eileen Chapman. Thank you.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Vote on that?
Okay. Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-266, authorizing settlement of workers' compensation claim caption Benjamin Diaz versus City of Asbury Park. Come a motion, please.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-267, authorizing settlement of workman's compensation claim caption Tyrone Smith versus City of Asbury Park. Have a motion, please.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-268, authorizing settlement workman's compensation claim, caption Cassandra Walker versus City of Asbury Park. Have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-269, authorizing appointment at Housing Authority. This is a reappointment, Gregory Hopkin. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
And that was Gregory Hopson Sr.
Resolution 2016-270, resolution of Mayor Council of the City of Asbury Park to support the submission of the application for New Jersey Department of Transportation Safe Routes to School Program. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-271, purchase of a John Deere tractor for Beach Utility. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-272. This is actually a three-part resolution. We have Resolution A, which is a resolution of the Mayor and Council of the City of Asbury Park acting as the redevelopment entity regarding the application Madison Asbury Retail LLC for conceptual review of the boutique camping project on Block 4502, lots 1.01 through 1.04. Can I have a motion to approve this resolution?
I think before you even move in second, there needs to be some dialogue.
Good evening, Mayor and Council, Carl County Redevelopment Council. As discussed and as requested by the council, three resolutions were prepared on the application. The application was presented on Monday night with some additional information submitted by Madison Asbury Retail. It's not working, I apologize. My eyes are going in my old age. And the three applications were split into three separate resolutions at the request of the council. One is for what is known as the boutique camping proposal, which is the resolution for you. The second is the shipping container retail proposal, and the third is the mobile retail and food vendor area proposal. The first resolution for the boutique camping proposal, and as discussed with the council, has been drafted to deny that request. And the language that was asked to be included states the mayor and council found that the boutique camping proposal does not constitute, quote, hotels, lodging, and conference facilities as permitted by the waterfront redevelopment plan as advanced by Madison Asbury Retail, is otherwise not a permitted use in the plan, does not advance the goals and principles of the plan. The boutique camping proposal is not granted conceptual approval, should not be referred to or considered by the planning board, and should not be constructed and or operated.
That's so just to place, can I put my reverse on the record?
Yes, certainly, okay. Ms. Quinn. That's just wanted to frame the resolution as was requested. So that's
the resolution. You need a motion and a second for a comment, right?
What do you want?
Yes.
Yes, you need a motion and a second to put it on the table for discussion. So yes. I recommend that you move and second it, and then council can engage in discussion.
Move it.
Second.
Just for the public's edification, and Carl obviously knows, I think this way, the subdevelopers agreement describes lodging as a temporary residence. I think camping on this site meets that. If we're debating that, I certainly think it meets the requirement of recreation. The redevelopment goals talk about generating tax revenue, and Madison Marquette has agreed to pay a hotel tax. It talks about using underutilized areas, which I think the glam camping does. It takes an area that essentially looks horrendous right now and I'll dress it up into something more attractive. I'm looking at my notes because I'm working tonight. that's essentially it. I think we either take chances on good ideas for a year, and if they bomb, they bomb, and we don't do them again. But to not take chances, I think, isn't, you know, certainly isn't my cup of tea.
Deputy Mayor, just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, you know, everybody has to speak up.
Is it picking up now? Yeah? How about this one? Yeah, this one's not working well. The, which we hadn't discussed, the hotel tax cannot be collected against this. It doesn't qualify as a hotel under the New Jersey law that allows the imposition of the hotel tax. So even though it was offered, not something that could be collected.
Okay, so the other parts of the redevelopment plan that it meets is to make Asbury Park a place for families, right? One of the 10 says two adults and two kids. To create a positive first impression on the on streets that are arriving into the city, which is obviously Lake Ave, which is off the casino. I mean, listen, I'm not going to name every single thing that I think it meets the subsequent redevelopers agreement and the goals of the redevelopment plan. I just wanted to put a few on the record. I'll rescind the hotel tax.
I just want to make sure the council understands that a vote of yes on this resolution is a vote to deny this.
Okay.
That's the way the resolution is written.
Okay.
Any other questions, comments? Roll call.
Councilmember Chapman?
No.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
No.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
3-2.
Motion approved. The next resolution.
Now that's on the tents, right?
Yes. That was on the camping, correct. The next resolution is 2016-272-B as in boy. This resolution solely addresses the mobile retail and food vendor area proposal. I'm sorry. No, this one addresses the retail shipping container project. And this is a motion to approve it and to refer to the planning board for further review and approvals. The conditions imposed upon it is that it shall be 1 year in length without further approval from the council, a maximum of two containers. They shall not be located in the beach access utility easement or any other easement on the area held by the city, and that the murals on the container shall be reviewed and approved by the planning board.
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions?
Just question. If you're approving it, is it a yes or a no?
So yes.
Yes. To okay. A yes vote would be to approve the application with the conditions presented.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
No.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Motion approved. Application's approved. The last resolution is 2016-272-C. This is related to the proposal that is called the mobile retail and food vendor area. The motion would be to approve the application, refer to the planning board for further review and approvals. The conditions on the approval is, again, 1 year without further approval from the mayor and council. Maximum of four trucks, be they food trucks, pop-up retail, and or carts, total of four of a combination of those. Same condition that they not be placed in the beach access utility easement or any other easement held by the city in this area, and that no generators of any kind are to be used in conjunction with the operation.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Thank you.
Next is Resolution 2016-273, Amendment to the 2016 Municipal Budget, Beach Utility. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're now on to ordinances. First ordinance is for introduction, ordinance 2016-27. An ordinance amending and supplementing section 7-20 entitled One-Way Streets, Chapter 7, Traffic of the Code of the City of Asbury Park. Have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
No.
Public hearing is scheduled for June 29, 2016. We now have second reading. The first one's 2016-20, refunding bond ordinance authorizing the issuance not to exceed $2,250,000 aggregate principal amount general obligation refunding bonds by the City of Asbury Park and the County of Monmouth, State of New Jersey, to the Monmouth County Improvement Authority for the purpose of refunding certain bonds heretofore issued by the city to the MCIA. Have a motion to open bond ordinance 2016-20 to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Any public comment? Motion to close?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor? Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-20?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-21, establishing a restricted parking space for use by handicapped persons at property located at 1310 3rd Avenue, designated as Block 1103, Lot 48 in the City of Asbury Park, and amending and supplementing Section 7-36 entitled Handicapped Parking of Chapter 7, Traffic of the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park. Have a motion to open the meeting to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to close.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-21.
Move.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-22, an ordinance amending Chapter 2, Section 63, Administration Set Aside Program. Motion to open to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to close?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-22.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-24, an ordinance creating Chapter 3, Section 39, Police Regulations, Police and Fire Alarm Systems. Motion to open 2016-24 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
Could you explain that?
Yes. Go ahead, Michael.
Yeah. Michael, you fixed the mistakes I emailed you in the ordinance about the alarm.
They gave the older version.
Oh, well, whatever version it was in my packet. Can you make sure that I emailed Michael on Monday. The first offense is not a fine?
Correct.
First two.
It's the first two are not a fine. First three. The first two are not a fine, and I sent you the language last night.
That's correct?
Well, I'll explain it.
The version that I have in the package has $50 for first offense and $100 for second.
So,
if you further in the ordinance, it states that the first two offenses do not count towards the penalty, and the third offense shall be the first offense for the fine.
Correct.
Explain what it is.
Explain what it is, though.
Yeah.
We didn't explain
it. Currently, the City of Asbury Park is one of the few cities that we know of. Actually, I've never heard of not having one before for registering burglar alarms. So this is an ordinance that actually allows for individuals to register the burglar alarm with the police department. Currently, we have many repeat offenders who have alarms that are registered that are going off 10, 15, 20 times, and the police department constantly goes out to go to a house where there's no issue. So this will actually regulate the burglar alarm, what the standards are, the industry standards, require the contractor to register it and ensure that it maintains in good condition. Your first two offenses are free. Obviously, you know, we know weather can happen. You can have electrical shortages, And then after that, there's a progressive amount of fines to make sure that your burglar alarm's in increasing order. But the police department has seen a large increase in responses, and we needed to regulate it.
And I did confirm that the language is in there indicating the property owner shall have two free false alarm or summons or issue.
Yes.
Yes.
It's on page 2 of the ordinance.
The ordinance was up there, Rita. Motion to close public?
Move it.
Second. Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-24?
Move it.
Second.
It'll be a little louder, honey. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-25, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 7 Traffic, Section 7-41 Metered Parking of the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park. Can I have a motion to open it to the public, please?
Move it.
This is just a cleanup ordinance to, this was the meter parking ordinance that was added into the traffic. It was last year. And it came in and it was a new section, and it came in so many different ways that this is really just putting that chapter together and making sure that all the references are proper. There's no changes being made to this ordinance. It's just making sure everything's referenced properly.
And I'll just clarify that there's no substantive changes to anything relating to metered parking. It's just when the codifier was putting all these various ordinances together, she's making all the language consistent.
Motion to close to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-25?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2016-26, approving and adopting amendment to the Central Business District Redevelopment Planning relating to review of certain uses within the Central Business District Redevelopment Area for sound mitigation matters. Can I have a motion to open this portion of the ordinance to the public, please?
Move it.
Second.
Yeah, you can talk about only about this. I don't know, but no, when there's open...
I listen to you guys talk about a lot of unrelated stuff, so... Anyway, we're back to sound mitigation. We're back to problems where usually about 9:30, 10 o'clock at night, the noise just permeates Asbury.
This ordinance is just...
Isn't it about sound mitigation?
Only for the CBD, Central Business District.
Okay.
So, okay, talk. But, well, so you can't talk aren't about
we talking, Stone Hall aren't anymore? We talking Maine, Cookman, and Ocean?
No.
Where's the Central Business District?
Right over here.
Where's that?
Cookman, what? Bang, Summerfield, Bond, Emory, downtown.
Okay, so Cookman's included?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So there's a lot of noise there. I mean, really bad noise, and it goes late. I wonder how all the residents upstairs can sleep. I wonder when they bought those million-dollar condos if they knew that they were in for 2, 3 in the morning for screaming, beeping horns, driving erratically, lots of crime, and horrible noise. So the question is, what I have is, why is it that a citizen looking at the ordinances as they are, be able to walk into the municipal court and sign a complaint for violation, for going over the noise limit, way over? Why is that? What prevents a citizen? And it says in the ordinance, who has the highest standing is the injured citizen. And I consider myself and a lot of other people injured because I don't want to hear that till 3 in the morning. I think it bothers little kids trying to sleep. It's horrible. I mean, at what point would we advocate for little kids and families over the interest of businesses? That's my position. No comment?
Wait a second. We're trying to digest your question. Doesn't this just go to 10 o'clock?
There's nothing in this ordinance that prevents any citizen from filing a complaint if they feel that there has been a noise violation.
There isn't?
What ordinance are you looking at?
Okay, so then why was I prevented from...
Okay, but are you looking at the ordinance we're adopting tonight or a different ordinance?
No, but that... Wait a minute. We're talking about sound mitigation?
No, we're talking about this specific ordinance, and that's all you can talk about. That's by state law. That's not my law. That's state law. Like, we can open this ordinance up to the public to talk about this ordinance, not about other subjects. Ernie, write a letter to the governor.
Let me ask you a question. Am I on the wrong subject here about sound?
No, but are you on the right ordinance? What ordinance are you reading off?
Well, I'm reading off the one that was updated and then the one that you're now proposing. So what's happening is there's a trail here of the original one,
and you said, now
the one that you're proposing, and basically the essence is you're relaxing every single standard on noise. And I wonder, like, at what point, why don't we just say, well, anybody can make any noise they want?
Well, I think you're misinterpreting, and you already said something Greg corrected, saying
all right, so then why when I'm on Cookman Avenue every weekend,
in this ordinance
the noise is just unbearable? Why is that?
There is nothing in this ordinance that says a citizen cannot make a complaint. You just heard the attorney say that.
I'm past that. Now I'm saying, how do we deal with the problem now? Why is it that the businesses feel like, you know what? We want to open the doors and blast the music and bother everyone. We're making a fortune. We're going to do it.
And then they will be shut down.
You got to be kidding me.
No.
You know,
somebody living upstairs will call and say, there's loud noise. A police officer will go there, take the correct action, and then we'll go from there. And then if the summons has to be issued, a summons has to be issued, then that's a premise report. And then liquor licenses are renewed. So if there's so many premise reports, then we can impose sanctions on these establishments. Again, like Jesse said, if you see it, call. I mean,
Mayor Moore, with all due respect, you know, what we're saying here is one thing. What happens between 10 p.m. and 3 a.m. in Asbury is uncanny and beyond belief. And for you to say that I'm reaching or off the issue is, and I don't think it's worth smiling either. I think because the board and the council approved all of this, when someone like myself, a citizen, a taxpayer, comes up and complains, your response is to laugh and say, we'll get back to you. But why can't I get a remedy where I can walk in and say, they're playing music at 90 decibels at 1 in the morning, aside from the fighting, drinking, people being thrown through plate glass windows, and then you say, well, no, it's very simple. Go up to municipal court and sign the complaint. It took me 3 hours for them to say, we're not going to give you probable cause.
That's a question that you already addressed that Mr. Capobianco is going to look into and give you an answer.
Really, Mr. Capobianco does not correspond with me. I have 27 emails about this to Mr. Capobianco. So for him to sit here and say, well, you know, I'm going to respond, is just not true.
This ordinance goes back to...
the noise.
Let me finish, please. It goes back to several months ago when it came to the city's attention that a restaurant like Toast, America's Cup, could not even play a radio at 10 o'clock in the morning, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. All music was stopped downtown. All music. So what this ordinance does is give places like that, Taka, everybody, the availability to play low music to 10 p.m. to 10 p.m.
We're getting somewhere. We're getting somewhere. And is there a decibel on that? What is it?
I don't know.
It's supposed to be 65. It's in the ordinance.
Okay, well then you should...
Then why is it I could stand on Cookman and get 80, I could stand by Portland and get 95?
When you do, please call the police.
Mayor Moore, you know when you call the police, the response is, we told them to put it down and they don't.
Well then...
So then what?
Then call the city manager, then call me, because that's stuff... You're hearing us up here to say, saying, if you see something, call. Well, so if you're saying you're calling, you're getting no responses, we want to know that also.
Well, are you saying then that in response...
I'm not going back to those two summonses you keep on holding up, because I already told you three times Mr. Capobianco will address that with you within the next several days. I know Mr. Capobianco is all Friday, so it's not going to be Fridays. So if you two want to get together tomorrow Thursday, I don't know what your schedule is.
I'm busy.
Well, when Will you meet with?
The answer to the question is that there's no probable cause at this point in time because our current judge can't hear it. Anytime Mr. McNolly comes to court, we need a conflict judge. And when the court administrator told Mr. McNolly it can't be heard for a probable cause hearing, it needs to go before a conflict judge, he walked away. So if Mr. McNolly wants to file the complaints for probable cause, we need to schedule a conflict judge. He didn't want to do it. He walked away. Ms. Green called me this morning after he left.
No, that's a pat. That's a nice pat answer, except that. Okay, well, I'm going to. But I was on the phone with Freehold, and they told me.
We're straying from the ordinance. Okay. Brad, we have to stay to the ordinance.
You know what? You powered me off the subject. And the issue was, when I was at court, Freehold told me that I had a right to file. And this thing about other matters, my private matters, where is a conflict judge, has nothing to do, and they said there's absolutely nothing preventing me.
We have to go back to the specific ordinance.
You know, the bottom line is let the noise continue, and you can smile all you want, but it's going to continue. And it's way over the limit, and no one's going to do. In other words, if I'm barred from doing this, how about you, Mayor? If I'm barred from doing it, Mayor, if I'm barred from doing it, why don't you do it? Well, if I'm barred from doing it, why don't you do it?
Do what?
Take care of this noise problem. Do it for me.
I don't go downtown at 1 o'clock.
Well, come out at 10 o'clock at night this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and you can help me.
If you have motion to close. Anything else on the ordinance, we'll listen to it.
Okay.
Motion to close.
Move it.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-26.
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor?